We know that Christina would dearly wish to be here in our midst, and hope it will not be too long before she can once again take her rightful place among us. But for today, and for those who don't already know us, David Gray and myself, Vanda McTaggart, are both worship leaders here in Galston, and we will be conducting this service. While it is our privilege to be here in this sanctuary, we know there are many others who are also unable to be with us in person, and we're delighted to be able to share worship online, whether through Facebook or later via the YouTube channel. David and I are indebted to Paul, who is taking care of filming today. It's not an easy task, well, not this morning. While Christina has become quite accustomed to this form of worship, David and I will probably be quite a challenge as we attempt to adapt to social media, so please bear with us. But now I have some intimations to share. As there have been no objections raised or review of the church accounts, these will be signed today and sent to be audited. The next intimation I have is actually dated back in January and comes from Emma Hill, Captain of Command Corps of the Salvation Army. And Emma says, to our friends at Galston Parish Church, thank you for the generous donation of toys and cash towards our Christmas appeal. At Christmas this year, we were able to help over 300 children with toys, and even more families with food. We are only able to help all these people due to the generosity of individuals and groups like yourself. Thank you again for your generosity. God bless. And I have another one here from David Richmond, Captain of the 3rd Galston Company of the Boys Brigade. And David reads, on behalf of the officers and boys of the Boys Brigade, 3rd Galston Company, I would like to thank you and your members very much for the generous cheque for £1,000 towards the cost of maintaining the BB Mission Hall during lockdown. Please convey our thanks to the board and session. Your support is much appreciated at this difficult time. Best wishes to David. And this morning we also have an Easter message from Charles Chilambula, our friend and laboratory technician on Homa Island in Malawi. Charles says, I wish you all a great Easter season. May the blood of our Lord Jesus protect you, your families, and Galston Church from the pandemic. Regards, Charles. Regrettably, our final intimation this morning is to pass on the sad news of the death on Thursday of Tilly McMillan. Tilly and her late husband Bill were much loved members of our congregation and of the community. Our deepest sympathy and prayers go to their family and friends at this site, at that time, and that is all our intimations. Now, before I pass you over to David to begin the service, we have a few important safeguarding reminders for everyone in attendance. Now, this is a bit like the safety message in a plane. If you can remember when it was you could get in a plane and you were asked to watch the churches, well, you don't have to fasten your seat belts, but we would ask you to remain in your seat and not wander around. Please keep your face coverings in place while you are in the building. David and I are allowed to move ours while in the chancel, but we must remain physically distanced throughout. At the end of the service, please remain seated until the stewards indicate it is safe for you to leave. And we respectfully ask that you exit the building and the grounds, observing safe distance, enabling everyone to exit the church safely. I'd say at this point, we also have a new scooter mobility ramp at the side here. I did get a signal in. At the north door, it's now fully operational, so that gives improved disabled access and egress on that side of the building. Unfortunately, under the current guidelines, we are still not allowed to serve tea or coffee after the service, but hopefully we're moving towards a time when we can resume our fellowship over a cuppa in the hall. And now, I pass over to David.
Good morning. I found this little poem I thought would be appropriate for our Easter, to start our Easter service. Some people think we worship an old rugged wooden cross. They laugh at us and say it was the way so many things to cause our Lord his loss, but the thing we remember most, he gave it on a cross. Our offerings will now be received. Let us pray. Heavenly Father, thank you that you can satisfy our every desire and need. Your words say that we should give honour to you with the first fruits of our wealth. Accept our tithes and offerings as a gift of worship to you. Multiply what we give for the effective growth of your kingdom. May Christ dwell in our hearts through faith, so that we, being rooted and grounded in love, and have strength to know the love of Christ. Loving God, we worship this Easter morning with no slight prescription for how we should be feeling, but exactly as we are. Some sad, some tired, some fearful, but with dawning hope and promise, the fleeting glimpses of joy. We come as we are, and trust against all odds that you will come and find us here. This we ask in your Son's name, who taught us to pray together, saying, Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come. Thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory forever. Amen. Now, as you know, we're not allowed to sing, which is unfortunate, because I know we all like to sing our hymns on a Sunday morning, but what we've decided, that Kathleen's going to play a nice hymn. The words are written on the pieces of paper in front of you, so I know you'll be singing within your hearts the words of Thine be the glory.
Thank you.
the word of God. Early on the first day of the week, while it was still dark, Mary Magdalene came to the tomb and saw that the stone had been removed from the tomb. So she ran and went to Simon Peter and the other disciple, the one whom Jesus loved, and said to them, "They have taken my Lord out of the tomb, and we do not know where they have laid him." Then Peter and the other disciple set out and went toward the tomb. The two were running together, but the other disciple outran Peter and reached the tomb first. He bent down to look in and saw the linen wrappings lying there, but he did not go in. Then Simon Peter came, following him, and went into the tomb. He saw the linen wrappings lying there, and the cloth that had been on Jesus' head, not lying with the linen wrappings, but rolled up in a place by itself. Then the other disciple, who reached the tomb first, also went in, and he saw and believed. For as yet they did not understand the scripture that he must rise from the dead. Then the disciples returned to their homes. But Mary stood weeping outside the tomb. As she bent over to look into the tomb, and she saw two angels in white, sitting where the body of Jesus had been lying, one at the head and the other at the feet. They said to her, "Woman, why are you weeping?" She said to them, "They have taken away my Lord, and I do not know where they have laid him." Amen. Thanks be to God.
A reflection this morning is looking at the aftermath of the crucifixion of Jesus through the eyes of Mary Magdalene. Mary Magdalene was one of a group of the women who were followers of Jesus through his ministry. And of course, lots of women have been in the news lately, some good, some bad. But now lots of women are at the forefront of the important positions in the world, with many as leaders in their countries. In the USA, the first woman vice president. In Scotland, the first minister is a woman. Here in Galston, Parish Church, we have our first woman lady minister, Christina, our first lady organist, Kathy, and our first lady session clerk, in Vanda. I just feel surrounded. So it's fitting today that today's story is told through the eyes of a woman, Mary Magdalene. Night was falling. Nicodemus and Joseph worked quickly, binding the body with long strips of linen and folding the few spices that they had with them as they worked. Finally and tenderly, they laid the body on a limestone niche in the new tomb. I watched as they rolled the massive stone into place across the opening. It was dark when we left. The Sabbath seemed to drag on endlessly. Despite my pain, I was determined to go back on Sunday morning to finish anointing the Master's body with spices. I owed him that. Saturday's sun finally dipped below the mountains. The Sabbath was over. I hurried to the spice merchant's shop and pounded on the door until he came downstairs and let me in. "Spices for a burial," I said. "No, I can't wait until the morning." Sleep came in snatches. Long before sun up, I was dressed to meet the two other women I had asked to help me. The grey dawn streaked across the sky as we set out. As we hurried along, Salome whispered, "Who will move the stone away?" Oh, the stone. I hadn't thought of that. As we came towards the tomb, we saw that the stone had already been pushed aside. I thought, grave robbers, why can't they leave him alone, even in death? I ran and ran until I found Peter and John. "They've taken the Lord's body out of the tomb, and I don't know where they have put him." After they came, Peter and John went off to tell the others. I went back to the tomb with the two women, where only the shroud wrappings remained. Suddenly, the tomb was lit up by a dazzling light and the appearance of two men. A voice said, "Why do you seek the living among the dead? You seek Jesus of Nazareth, who was crucified, but he is not here, for he is risen," he said. After the two men disappeared, we were dazed by what they told us. "Risen," said somebody, "we have to tell disciples what we have seen." As they ran off, I sat down in the garden trying to make sense of it all. How could Jesus be alive? I had washed the corpse myself. Was this too good to be true? Could I cling to something this wonderful? I didn't want my hopes dashed again. But if it was true, I thought, then Jesus' whole life had a meaning. If it was true, then he was Messiah after all. Then the one who had healed me had conquered death itself, if it was true. Just then, footsteps intruded my thoughts. I looked up. It must be the gardener. "Woman, why are you weeping? Who are you looking for?" I said, "Don't you know who had been buried here? If you took his body away, please tell me where you have put him." He did not answer. "Mary," I looked up at his face. It was Jesus. "Rabboni, teacher," I dropped to my knees. My Lord was alive, very alive. "I have seen the Lord," I told the disciples. They were cynical. "Sure, Mary, why should the Lord appear to you, a woman?" Why indeed, I wondered later. He had appeared to his disciples later that same day, but I had been the first. Was it that he really accepted me, or to prove his forgiveness was forever? Why? I was never sure, but one thing that I do know, our Lord lives.
On this Easter morning. breathe new life, breathe into creation. This is the day which brought joy to the earth and gives us hope. We will rejoice and be glad in it. We pray for the resurrection of hope and joy in our world today, in this church and all churches throughout the world, and in us, your ever hopeful, sometimes joyful, still faithful people. Amen. Now our second and final hymn is number 194. You might have heard a few clues through there. It's This is the Day. Now you can follow the words on the hymn sheets in front of you, but as before, you must leave it to those at home to do the singing. Hymn 194.
Holy Spirit be among you and remain with you now and